The development of electricity and its application has a great history. In 600 BC, Thales of Miletus, a Greek mathematician, astronomer, and philosopher, could produce a field of electricity when he found that when amber is rubbed with silk, it attracts small particles of straw and produces spark. The Greek word of amber is electron, and from that we got the names like electricity, electronics, and electrons. Thales was also the person who saw the attraction between the pieces of natural magnetic rock called lodestone, and from that concept the words magnet and magnetism were derived. There were many scientists and genius minds. Those have contributed to the development of electricity and its application. Michael Faraday was among them, those geniuses who came up with the basic principle of electricity. Michael Faraday was among those geniuses who came up with the basic principle of electricity, and he came up with the idea in the year 1831. His revolutionary idea was that a changing magnetic field could produce electricity. After Faraday and the other scientists' contribution to this matter, there was another great scientist called James Clerk Maxwell, who gave the mathematical shape to the concept of electricity in a systematic manner. He did that by giving the mathematical concept of electricity and magnetism. In fact, he is considered as the founder of electromagnetic theory. Later, Albert Einstein and others related the five forces of physics in a grand unified theory in which Maxwell's equation became a special case. And those five forces of physics are electric and magnetic forces, gravity, and the so-called weak and strong forces. So in this topic, we will going to talk about all these forces in detail. So let's start our discussion with the force called gravity, because it is very common and well-known force among us. In our everyday life, gravity plays an important role. Gravity is basically the attraction between two objects that have mass or energy. Whether there is a dropping rock from a bridge, or a planet orbiting a star, or the moon causing the tidal waves, all are this happening because of gravity. In summary, one of the main reasons behind the human existence is gravity, because the main reason behind the existence of atmosphere is gravity. Anyway, Isaac Newton was the first to propose the idea of gravity. Supposedly, he was inspired by a falling apple from a tree. He described gravity as a literal attraction between two objects. But centuries later, his definition about gravity tilted because of Einstein's theory of general relativity. According to the theory of general relativity, the gravity is not an attraction or a force. Instead, it is a consequence of object bending space-time. The general theory of relativity says that a large object like sun can bend the space-time. It is a bit like a large ball placed in the middle of a sheet that affects that material. It will deform it and causing other small objects on the sheet to fall forward in the middle. And we are seeing the examples of this in our everyday life. In our solar system, the sun is in the middle and all the planets are revolving around it because of gravity. Gravity looks like a very strong force, because gravity holds planets, stars, and the solar system, and even galaxies together. But it turns out to be the weakest of all fundamental forces, especially at the molecular and atomic scales. Think of it this way. How hard is it to lift a ball off the ground, or to lift your foot, or to jump? All of these actions are counteracting the gravity of the entire Earth. And at the molecular and the atomic level, gravity has almost no effect relative to the other fundamental forces. After gravitational force, we have to discuss about the weak force. What is so-called weak force? The weak force is the weak nuclear interaction which is responsible for particle decay. This is the literal change of one type of subatomic particle into another. To understand it, we have to go through an example. Suppose a neutrino that strays close to a neutron can turn the neutrino into a proton, while the neutrino itself becomes an electron. The physicists describe this interaction through the exchange of force-carrying particles called bosons. There are specific kinds of bosons which are responsible for the weak force, electromagnetic force, and strong force. In the weak force, the bosons are charged particles called W bosons and Z bosons. When subatomic particles such as proton, neutrons, and the electrons come within 10 to the power 18 meters or 0.1% of diameter of proton of one another, they can exchange these bosons. As a result, the subatomic particle decay into new particles. The weak force is critical for the nuclear fusion reactions that power our sun and produce the energy needed for the most life forms here on Earth. It is also why the archaeologists can use carbon-14 for dating the ancient bone, wood, and the other formerly living artifacts. Because the carbon-14 has 6 protons and 8 neutrons, one of these neutrons decays into a proton to make the nitrogen-14, which has 7 protons and the 7 neutrons. This decay happens at a predictable rate, allowing scientists to determine how old such artifacts are. Now, electromagnetic force. The electromagnetic force, also called the Lorentz force, that acts between charged particles, like negatively charged electrons and positively charged protons. The opposite charge attracts one another, while the like charge repel. The greater the charge, the greater the force. And much like gravity, this force can be felt from an infinite distance. As its name indicates, the electromagnetic force consists of two parts, the electric force and the magnetic force. At first, physicists described these forces as they separate from one another, but researchers later realized that there are two components of the same force. The electric component acts between charged particles, whether they are moving or stationary, creating a field by which the charge can influence each other. But once set into motion, those charged particles began to display the second component, the magnetic force. The particles create a magnetic field around them as they move. So when the electrons zoom through a wire to charge your computer or your phone or turn on your TV, then the wires become magnetic. Electromagnetic forces are transferred between the charged particle through the exchange of massless force-carrying bosons called photons, which are also called the particles' components of light. The force-carrying component that swap between charged particles, however, are a different manifestations of photons. They are virtual and undetectable, even though they are technically the same particle as the real and detectable version. The electromagnetic force is responsible for some of the most commonly experienced phenomena, the phenomena like friction, elasticity, the normal force and the force holding solids together in a given shape. It is even responsible for the drag that birds, planes and even Superman experience while flying. These actions can occur because of charged particles interacting with one another. The normal force that keeps a book on the top of the table, for example, that is a consequence of electrons in a table's atom repelling electrons in the book's atoms. After electromagnetic force, now it is time for the strong nuclear force. The strong nuclear force is also called the strong nuclear interaction. This is the strongest of the four fundamental forces of nature. It is 6,000 trillion 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 times stronger than the force of gravity. And that's because it binds the fundamental particles of matter together to form the larger particles. It holds together the quarks that makes up the protons and the neutrons. And part of the stronger forces also keep the protons and the neutrons of atoms' nucleus together. Much like weak force, the strong forces operates only when subatomic particles are extremely close to one another. They have to be somewhere within 10 to the power minus 15 meters from each other, or roughly within the diameter of proton. The strong force is odd because unlike any other fundamental forces, it gets weaker as the subatomic particles move close together. It actually reaches maximum strength when the particles are farthest away from one another. Once within range, massless charged bosons called the gluons transmit the strong force between quarks and keep them glued together. A tiny fraction of the strong force called the residual strong force acts between protons and neutrons. The protons in the nucleus repel one another because of the similar charge, but the residual strong force can overcome this repulsion, so the particles stay bound in atom's nucleus. After discussion of all our forces, we have reached to an outstanding question, and the question is whether these fundamental forces actually manifestation of just a single great force of the universe. If so, each of them should be able to merge with others, and there is already an evidence that they can. The physicists Sheldon Glashow and Steven Weinberg from Harvard University and Abdus Salman from Imperial College of London won the Nobel Prize in Physics in 1979. For unifying the electromagnetic force with weak force to form the concept of the electroweak force. The physicists working to find the so-called grand unifying theory aimed to unite the electroweak force with the strong force to define an electronuclear force, which models have predicted but researchers had not yet observed. The final piece of puzzle would then requiring the unifying gravity with electronuclear force to develop the so-called theory of everything, a theoretical framework that could explain the entire universe. So this is the puzzle we have to solve. So this is the end of the topic. I hope you will going to like it. So thank you very much. Thank you for your support.